Praise the Lord. Good evening, everyone. It's good to see each one here tonight. We say God bless you. We're glad to be here. Say amen. Once again, if you'll turn around and yell at your neighbor, tell them I love you and you can't do nothing about it. Praise the Lord. Amen. Hallelujah. If you would, please repeat after me and say, this is the best day and the best year that I've ever had, because Jesus is with me. One more time. This is the best day and the best year that I've ever had, because Jesus is with me. Let's give him a clap offering. Amen tonight. Praise the Lord. Let's continue to pray for people that really need a touch. Let's remember Johnny in his car and Michael in his car today. Let's remember Bruce tonight. I know they're going on the 15th, is that correct? For another doctor visit? On the 5th, August 5th, okay. That's even better, so it's closer. Right? Different doctor, okay. Let's pray that they will do this surgery we believe that needs to be done. And let's pray that God will send them right help. Amen for them. Amen. Praise the Lord. Anyone else tonight before we go into prayer this morning? Yeah, let's remember she's pretty much been sick all week. She had some kind of virus, so appreciate that. Let's remember a little bit. Tonight, amen. And some others I know, they said they had trouble with it, amen. Anyone else tonight with a prayer request? Sister Marilyn?
The next day I couldn't walk. And they took me to the hospital, the doctor's office. They put me on narcotics that just knocked me out. And I'm a big guy, 290 pounds. And back in the streets, you know, I could do more than that. But these things knocked me out, and I slept and slept and slept, and slowly over time, I got better and got better and got better. But you know what? There I was laying on the floor, and my godmother, my cousin, my wife, they all came. They laid hands on me. They anointed me with oil, and I could not get up. And I was in so much pain. I never had that pain before in my life, and I was stuck there. But they prayed, they prayed. My godmother rebuked the devil, rebuked the enemy, and I was able to stand, not on my own at that time, but with the help of all of them, they lifted me up. And it reminded me of times when I think I'm alone, and even though I'm down, and then I'm not out, but down, there are those around me who lift me up. And I know your prayers have been there for us as we were gone all this time. This morning, I came upon this and I thought about how God's Holy Spirit comes to us, not only to give us direction, but also to speak to God on our behalf, letting us know the things of God that we don't understand. There I was, a child of God, and I thought about, you know what, enemy? You've been playing with my mind all this time, but it's going to be over. I realized that, once again, I don't know how I forgot it, Pastor, but I realized exactly what was happening, and I knew that God was for me. And those words, fear not, for I am with you, came to my mind. But this is what I read. 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 9, Amplified. But on the contrary, as the scripture says, what the eye has not seen and ear has not heard and has not entered into the heart of man, all that God has prepared, made and keeps ready for those who love him, who hold him in affectionate reverence, promptly obeying him and gratefully recognizing the benefits he has bestowed. Yet to us God has unveiled and revealed them by and through his Spirit. For the Holy Spirit searches diligently, exploring and examining everything, even sounding the profound and bottomless things of God, the divine counsels and hidden and beyond man's scrutiny. For what person knows, perceives and knows and understands what passes through a man's thought except the man's own spirit within him? just so no one discerns or comes to know and comprehend the thoughts of God except the Spirit of God. Now, we have not received the Spirit that belongs to the world, but the Holy Spirit, who is from God, given to us that we might realize and comprehend and appreciate the gifts of divine favor and blessings so freely and lavishly bestowed on us by God. And we are setting these truths forth in words not taught by human wisdom, but taught by the Holy Spirit, combining and interpreting spiritual truths with spiritual language to those who possess the Spirit, the Holy Spirit. As I was praying about these things, and all these questions started coming in my life, a place to live, the sickness in my body, the defects in my car, I don't know what God's blessing has, but I know it's there, and I believe on it, and it's true, and I started praying about these things, speaking in tongues, and He started to reveal things to me, that He was there for me through all of it. And a lot of things can come upon a person in this life, as he's going through troubles and trials, but God is with you there. That's the one thing you have to remember, God is with you there. Haven't you been in a place that was much more worse than the place you're in now? You got out of it. God was with you there. Once you found God, He didn't just find a friend that's going to leave you and walk away when your times are down, but someone's going to stick with you through it all. You just got to stick with Him through it all. Father God, we thank You and praise You for this time, Lord Father God, for this house that's open to us, Father God, to come and to receive of You, Lord Father God. I ask a blessing upon each one of Your children today, Father God, that are here, Lord Father God. Bless them in their lives and whatever they're going through, Father God. Help them through it, Lord Father God, as You've helped me so many times before, Father God. I trust in You today, Lord Father God, that You will see a way through it all for us, Lord Father God. And as we have faith in You, Lord Father God, reveal to us the things, Father God, that You desire us to do in You, Lord Father God. I ask You, Father God, to bless this offering, Father God. Bless this service, Father God, and bless the lives of Your children today in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Your own.
Praise the Lord. Amen. We have a few announcements tonight we don't want to forget. We're getting close to August already, coming towards the end of the summer. And so let's not forget some of these events we have. Pastor Dan will be with us the 10th and the 13th. Let's remember these days, and he will be with us to teach on Sunday and Wednesday. We're also going to have Ted and Penny Hunter on the 17th. They will be with us in the morning. And coming up in September, we're going to have Carlos and Julie, who've been with us before, one on the 14th of September, and one, I believe it's the 5th of October. So let's remember those days as well. Let's keep praying for all the events coming up. Amen. Just pray for the church too. We have lots of people that are having difficulty at this time. Lots of people are struggling with the $4 a gallon gas, and they do not have gas to go all the places they want to. And so let's pray that God will bless them. And I noticed this morning while I was teaching, there are people that at least from my perspective, need help financially. So let's remember them tonight. Amen. God will bring them the finances that they need. Amen. Praise the Lord. We're going to get started in the lesson. All right, well, let's turn tonight to Hebrews chapter 4. Praise the Lord. I need you to smile really big and turn to your neighbor and tell them this is a friendly church. Amen. This is a friendly church. I don't want to start while I feel endangered. Can we say amen? Hebrews chapter 4. We're going to ask Brother Johnny, would you ask the blessing on the word tonight?
Order people,
Amen. We're going to just go ahead and read this tonight, if it's all right. Praise the Lord. Hebrews chapter 4, verse 1. Let us therefore fear, lest the promise being left us of entering into his rest, any of you should seem to come short of it. For unto us was the gospel preached as well as unto them. But the word preached did not profit them, not being mixed with faith in them that heard it. For we which have believed do enter into rest, as he said, as I have sworn in my wrath, that they shall enter into my rest, although the works were finished from the foundation of the world. For he spake in a certain place of the seventh day on this wise, and God did rest the seventh day from all of his works. And in this place again, if they shall enter into my rest, seeing therefore it remaineth that some must enter therein, and they to whom it was first preached entered not in because of unbelief. Again, he limited a certain day, saying in David, today, after so long a time, as it is said, today, if you will hear his voice, harden not your hearts. For if Jesus had given them rest, then he would not afterward have spoken of another day. There remaineth therefore a rest to the people of God. For he that is entered into his rest, he also has ceased from his own works, as God did from his. Let us labor therefore to enter into that rest, lest any man fall after the same example of unbelief. For the word of God is quick and powerful, and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing asunder of soul and spirit, and of the joints in the marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. Neither is there any creature that is not manifest in his sight, but all things are naked and open unto the eyes of him with whom we have to do. Seeing then that we have a great high priest that is passed into the heavens, Jesus the Son of God, let us hold fast our profession. For we have not a high priest which cannot be touched with the feelings of our infirmities, but was in all points tempted like as we are, yet without sin. Verse 16, let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. Now I want to spend a little time, not only on the last verse, but on what Paul is talking to the church, or the Hebrew church. If you don't know the story of the Hebrew children coming out of Egypt into the Promised Land, that they saw all the great miracles that God provided for them, but they were not persuaded to go into the Promised Land. Joshua and Caleb were, and of course Moses was as well. But the other people were not persuaded. And in here they use the term unbelief, and we'd like to explain that a little bit further. There are a lot of people that say they believe in God, but they do not show actions with their faith. I've had a lot of people tell me they believe in God, and the lifestyle they lead is terrible. And in this case, a man explained it in this fashion. James said, faith without works is dead. But here, if you're not willing to act on your faith, it's a form of unbelief. Not acting on your faith is a form of unbelief. And the Bible said here, in your hearing, it said they did not please God because they were unwilling to act on faith. Caleb and Joshua were willing to act on their faith, but the rest of the people were not, and so they wandered into the wilderness. And so God made a statement here. They cannot enter into my rest because of their unbelief. Now tonight I want to spend a few minutes here in this passage because I feel like it's important. Number one, we talk about that as Christians we have the right to enter in to the holiest of all, as servants of God. But I want to qualify that statement tonight because we have to be born again in order for us to enter in to the holiest of all. Just because we go to church, or just because we know somebody that's a Christian, or a grandmother or grandfather, somebody we know is saying amen and we're trying to get in on their coattails, it doesn't mean that. Hello? I know lots of people that are trying to get in that way. Amen. The seven sons of Sceva, amen. We rebuke you by the Jesus whom Paul preached. That didn't work. Amen. No, they all got beat up. Amen. The issue here is you have to be born again to be able to enter into the holiest of all. You have to make a covenant with God, and you have to be right with God when you go in there. In the Old Testament, the priest had to do it. He had to get sanctified. And what that means, he took, amen, before the time he was going to go in there. He adjusted his diet. He abstained from several things. And he prayed and he got sanctified so he could go in to the holiest of all. If he had gone in there, they actually tied a rope around him. And had he gone in there and any sin would be found in him, he would have died in the presence of God, and they would drag him out by the rope, because if somebody other than the high priest went in there, they'd be dead too. Amen. You might think it's strange the way God operates, but in the Old Testament, there was a man by the name of Uzzah who, when they were bringing the Ark of the Covenant, they brought it up on an oxen cart, which is not the way that God told them to bring or carry the Ark. And so the oxen shook it, and it looked like it was going to fall over. And Uzzah touched the Ark to settle the Ark, to steady it. And when he did, God struck him dead. And in that example, God said nobody is supposed to touch the Ark except the priests, Judah, tribe of Levi. Amen. So when we don't do things correctly, we can get into trouble. But what I'm going at tonight, thank God we're not in the Old Testament. You can smile and be okay, because you're not going to die tonight if you go in with the wrong attitude. Oh, thank the Lord for that. Amen. I won't get struck dead tonight. Amen. We're not under the same covenant. Amen. You think I'm kidding, but I wouldn't go into the holiest of all if I didn't think I was right. Amen. But now today, we need to take the same example that we need to be right with God when we approach Him. Most people, amen, have a tender heart. And if there is something between you and God before you pray and begin to pray, usually your prayer goes, God, please forgive me for thus and thus. I guess I'm the only one. Amen. Lord, forgive me. Amen. Forgive me. Make sure I'm covered. Amen. Because He doesn't want to hear anything else till we get that straightened out. Amen. But then after that, I have the right, because I'm a Christian, to enter into the holiest of all. And it said here that I can obtain grace and mercy to get help in time of need. So in my prayer life and in my time of intercession, I have the right, number one, to get into the presence of God and then obtain His grace and mercy for me. It doesn't mean everybody gets it, but because I am a believer and I'm born again, that includes me. Come on, say to yourself, that includes me. Hello? God wants us to get in there and obtain the promises and receive from His hand. And even though we have battles, all of us do, the grace and mercy of God's going to help us. That's why we need to pray. If this was automatic, praise God, I would never have to pray again. Hello, if it was all automatic, if everything God wanted to do for me was automatic, I'm going to go home and have a siesta. I'm just done. Amen. Hello. But it doesn't work that way. It works by us going in to our prayer closet and going into the holiest of all and begin to intercede, amen, and to pray not only for ourselves, but for all those we people that need help. We're supposed to pray for the sick. Come on. In the book of Timothy, it said we're supposed to pray for all those in authority. We're supposed to pray for those that not only authority in the state, but in the church as well. We're supposed to pray for everyone we know that's sick. We're supposed to pray for those that are afflicted. We're supposed to be interceding for people that need to get saved. Can I get a witness? We're supposed to be taking time to pray for other people. If we don't do that, we're not doing what we're supposed to, and we're not taking our responsibility. But we're not listening to everything the Word of God has to say, because we have the right to go in the holiest of all. And so when we go in there, we can petition God for unsaved loved ones right in His presence. Hello. When we go to pray for somebody that's sick, we get to go right into the presence of God, just like a high priest would go, amen, in times past, into the holiest of all, where God sat on the mercy seat, and we can obtain the same grace and mercy that Aaron or anybody else got in the Old Testament. We get to do it because Jesus is interceding in our prayers. Hello? You may not be encouraged about when you pray, but you need to change your mind when you pray. Something good is going to happen to you if you pray. Hello, something really good will happen to you because you're not just praying. Jesus is praying and He's taking it to the Father. And I'll tell you, if anybody knows how to pray, it's Jesus, amen. Come on, if anybody can get rid of a devil, it's Jesus. If anybody can touch God's heart, Jesus can do it. And when we pray, He is our high priest, amen. And that's what this is talking about. Hello? You don't get through this without praying. You got to at least pray. Amen. You got to do something with what you got. You got to pray. And God will begin to move on your behalf and bring restoration to you. Can you say amen? Amen. Hallelujah. I find it amazing that people want to pray just one prayer. Years ago, I've had people, in fact, they still teach it on TV. They'll tell you all you have to do is pray one time. Just once, and God will listen to you. Well, I hate to disappoint you, but if you ever study prayer, you'll find that there's more than just one kind of prayer. There's more than one kind of prayer. Amen. Here we go. Prayer of faith, prayer of agreement, prayer of unity, prayer of dedication, prayer of commitment. Prayer for salvation. Hello. It's going to take me a while, but amen. There's a number of different types of prayers, and they go by different rules. And I'll give you examples. The prayer of agreement works when you and I agree on something. If I'm believing and you're hoping, that's not an agreement. Hello. I've gone places, amen. I've gone to the hospital to pray for people. And I just as well prayed for the bedpost as I did the person. Amen. They didn't know. They weren't receiving anything. Amen. Y'all don't listen to me. I can tell the difference. Amen. I go to pray for somebody and they don't believe it at all. And I've seen other people we prayed that they said they would never come out of the hospital. And they got in, amen, out of the hospital. They got in their car and drove it home. Oh, amen. So if you want to get this to work, you have to begin to apply it the way that God intended for you to do that. Number one, you got to be born again. And number two, if you got something between you and God, you got to get it corrected. And then number three, you can begin to intercede and begin to pray. Amen. Now someone said, I have a problem that seems so too much for me. It seems I'm overwhelmed with it. Well, that's when you need to find yourself a prayer warrior. It's awful quiet in this place. Amen. If you're strong enough to pray for everything and never need anybody, come on up here. I want you to lay hands on me. Hello. Man, I've many times gone into my prayer closet and said, oh, God, how are we going to get through this? Amen. God, how are we going to survive this attack? How are we going to get through this situation? What Johnny was talking about. Tonight, one of my favorite scriptures is 1 Corinthians 10:13. And it says, God will not put on you more than you can bear. I'm going to have a fit right now. Glory to God. Amen. But he will, with the trial and test, make a way for you to escape that you might be able to bear. And I realize that even though in my own mind it may be overwhelming to me, but God will never put on me or you something too hard for us to bear. But he'll make a way for us to escape. Some way, somehow, we'll get through to the other side. Even though it's overwhelming or difficult or whatever you want to call it, amen, God will not put on us more than we can bear. And he is in control and not the devil. Hello? If the devil's in control, you're going to lose out tonight. Amen. He will most certainly put on something you can't get off. That's all we're glad. If you think the devil likes you, you're seriously mistaken. Hello? If he was going to come after you with no restraint, listen to me. He would come after you with no restraint, but he can't do that. Thank God. Amen. And you can't see him right now, but I got an angel out here. I don't know where he's at, but he's out here. Amen? And the Bible says, Psalm 35, if you don't know this, you ought to write it down. He's going to chase my enemies. Hello? Come on. Y'all need to study your Bible. Amen? I know I got power over the devil, but I also got an angel, amen, that will keep me protected. He will deliver me. He'll help me. Amen. I got an angel. Amen. He's bad news. You don't want to mess with him. Amen. The scripture says, touch not my anointed and do my prophets no harm. You don't want to mess with me. I'm telling you. Amen. I got some help tonight. Amen. It's awful quiet in this place. There's so much information in this book. You can't do one sermon justice, especially when you get into prayer. Because you have such wonderful opportunities to begin to intercede and become a different kind of person than what you used to be. When you were in the world, you had to find a way to solve your problem. Hello. And if you were like me, you made a decision, but it doesn't mean you always made the right one. Hello. And I made a lot of decisions that caused me a lot of trouble. I'm the only one, amen? I almost died with the decisions that I made, hello? You can make a decision, but it doesn't mean it's a good one. And you can keep making them, but I'm telling you, if you don't line it up with the Word of God, you are headed for trouble more than you can handle, hello? And I found, amen, after 21 years of making my own decision, that I wasn't very good at it. Someone said, I'm pretty smart. You're not smart enough. Hello? If you're like me, you about did yourself in making your own decisions. And so now we have a different lifestyle. Now we can come in and pray and ask God for his grace and mercy to help us. Amen. Hello. I cannot tell you how many times in life I thought I was going to go this way. And after prayer, I ended up going that way. Hello. And I said to the Lord, this is the way I want to go. He said, no, this is the way you need to go. The flesh doesn't want to do it. This is the way I want to go. Are you listening to me, Lord? I want to go this way. And the Lord said, no, you got to go this way. And I cannot tell you how many times I wanted to do things and the Lord said, no. This is it. This is what I have for you. I'm telling you tonight, amen, some of you are right in the perfect will of God and you think you're going the wrong way. And in reality, you're going exactly the way that God wants you to. But your flesh doesn't want to go that way. So you've got to change your attitude and say, yes, Lord, I will go where you tell me to go. And I will do what you tell me to do. Hallelujah. Someone told me a while back, if it wasn't a trial, if it didn't try you, it wouldn't be a trial. In other words, it's a test. It's testing your faith. It's trying you in some way. Otherwise, it wouldn't be a trial. You'd just be sailing along somewhere. And so when you begin to pray and you begin to enter in to the things of God, now you have a different life because you were promised to go where God told you to go. Now you've got to intercede and let God guide you where He wants you. Oh, hallelujah. I was talking this morning about how many times God has bailed me and this church out over the years. And there's lots of times where it gets overwhelming to me, and I do not know how I'm going to get through it. I just know that this is the place that God called me, and to go somewhere else is only going to cause me more trouble. I wish I could get out of trouble. I wish I didn't have any trouble. I wish I didn't have any problems. Hello? I wish I didn't have difficulty, but I do. And if I run away from the presence of God, I'm going to have worse problems. Jonah found that out. Amen. If he thought it was bad where he was at, amen, just get thrown over the side of the ship and let a whale swallow you up. Amen. I'll take it tonight. Whatever it is, Lord, I'm staying here. I'll take my test or trial right here. I don't need a whale kind of test. Hello? I know lots of people that have left the presence of God and got into more trouble they can think of. I don't wish it on anybody, but it happens. And if you leave the presence of God, you're going to get into trouble. Because the place that God wants to bless you at, I think about it all the time, this is where God wants to bless me. If I leave here, my blessing is going to come here. I'll be gone. I'll be in Nevada. Can we get a witness? Amen. God will send the blessing here and I'll be in Nevada, and I don't get the blessing, somebody else will get it. Y'all not listening to me tonight. That's all right. I'm a different person. I can't go just any place. I can't do just anything. I can't just make any kind of decision because I know it won't be pleasing. So that's my prayer time is coming up now. And I'll get in my prayer closet and I'll ask the Lord, okay, Lord, what are we going to do now? One of the things my family has always liked me to tell them, and I tried to do it, and when they were growing up, when my boys were little, and my wife as well, I tried to do it on a constant basis. I would tell them, I'm not going anywhere. Hello? I'll be here. I'm sticking with you. Even though you're a little ornery, I'm going to stick with you. Can I get a witness? Amen. I told this church, I'll be back next week. Hello, I will be back. Y'all know, listen to me. I have to make a statement, and I don't know how many devils I may fight till next Sunday, but I'm not going to go anywhere. I'm going to stay in the presence of God. It's a battle. It's not easy, but I already promised God I would do it. I'm not going anywhere. Amen. It's a battle. Things don't work the way I like it to work. People don't always get along. Hello? If I could figure out how to get people to get along, I'll write me a book tonight. Amen? You betcha. Amen. I'll write it and I'll be a rich preacher too. Amen? I'll be driving one of those Bentleys. Amen? Just kidding. I wouldn't waste my money on one. God brought in people in the ministry. He brought in Gideon into a place, and Gideon was extremely fearful. And Gideon, the angel said to Gideon, Hail there, greeted him, thou mighty man of God. And Gideon's like, are you serious? You're talking to the wrong brother. He was behind a barn threshing wheat, and the only way you can thresh wheat is out in the open and preferably on a hillside, and you throw it up in the air, they let the oxen walk on it, and they throw it in the air, and the chaff blows away, and the wheat falls to the ground. The brother was throwing the stuff up in the air, and it was falling in his face. It wasn't the wheat going nowhere. And the angel said, hail thou, mighty man of God. But in the process of Gideon talking to the angel, and he began to fleece and do all kinds of stuff, but he began his relationship with God. He finally got to the place where he yielded to the Holy Spirit, and he went and did what God told him to do, and they won a great victory against the Midianites. He changed from the way he was behind that barn to going out and surrounding the enemy, and the only thing they took was candles, pitchers, and a trumpet. Come on, amen. I say it all the time. I don't know that I had the guts and the courage to go out there. Give me a sword or a bow and arrow or something, amen. No, it won't work. It won't work. Candles, pitchers, and a trumpet. It's the only way it works. They went out there and they blew the trumpet and they broke the pitcher and the light flashed throughout the camp and they said the sword of the Lord in Gideon. And those crazy people began to kill each other. Hello. He changed though. He was a different person from the time he left the back of that barn till the time they went up there to surround the enemy. I don't know about you tonight, but this is one preacher that wants the victory so bad I can taste it. I don't want to run from no devil. I'm not going anywhere. Hello. But not only that, do I want the victory? Yes, I want the victory tonight. I want to get it from the hand of God. I want to see the glory of God flow in this house, in this place, among this people. And I'm going to stand my ground till I see it happen. Amen. The power of God is already flowing, but we're going to see it even in a greater measure. If we won't quit or give up or go another direction, we will see God deliver us and set us free. Hallelujah. Amen. And I learned a long time ago, I get it. I get the trial and test. The devil comes around and tries to make it look really bad. He'll magnify it, amen, as much as he can to me. Hello. But when we see him, according to Isaiah, we are going to narrowly look upon him and say, is this the guy that messed us over? I'm glad I read that, amen. I used to was really afraid of the devil. But when I read that, I realized he's just a little guy with a big mouth. Can I get a witness, amen? And we got to stand our ground. Y'all don't listen to me. You got to stand your ground against that guy because he just runs his mouth. He makes things look like they're real and they're not. And the only way that you can defeat him is to stand on the promises of God. And if you'll do that, you will make him leave your presence and he will go find somebody else that he can deceive. I cannot, we've been preaching on a lot. I cannot believe all the people that I know that are deceived tonight. I cannot believe how many people that the devil has deceived. They think they're okay tonight and they're not. They teach things that's abomination in the sight of God and they do it every week and they think they're on fire for God and they've lost sight of the King. I don't know what happened to them, but I don't want it to get on me. Hello. It's amazing, amen. It's almost like when we see it, the time of sickness go through our city or our state, amen, the influenza or whatever goes through. It just seems like it hits people. And this deception seems like it's hit a lot of people, and they would rather listen to the deception than God. Because you have to stand your ground if you're going to live for God. You can't change your mind. Amen. The tenets of the faith of this church have not changed since they established it. Amen. And really, the Pentecostal church, the tenets of faith have not changed for 2,000 years. The things that we believe tonight, Peter, James, John, amen, all the brothers, Paul, they all believe the same things. Can I get a witness? Amen. They've been preaching it, amen, people have, for 2,000 years. Glory to God. And it's not going to change. If you don't want to agree with it, that's okay, but it's not changing. The book isn't going to change. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise God. I want you to picture tonight, because I know a lot of people have trouble doing this. I want you to picture yourself tonight going into the Holy Spirit. I want you to picture yourself going in to the presence of God like Aaron did. And there was cherubims, they were made out of gold. And the mercy seat was there. And the Lord sat on the mercy seat. And then you get to go in there and talk to him. And then you get to explain to him all your difficulties.
Hello?
And I got through money, and I got through Tuesday, and I got through Wednesday. devil can't be like you with just because the devil couldn't steal my joy anymore. And then that guy passed on Wednesday, and I started standing on the Word of God on Thursday, Friday, and Saturday, and I was blessed through the entire week. It's bad.
But you can do it. Amen.
Hello, because I'm not basing it on my feelings.
If I do, it's Disneyland, killing it with this. Amen.
My wife and I have a thing we've almost done.
We can get anywhere in here. Disneyland.
We
do
like seeing the man on the
first. I see the man. You don't do it, we do. Amen. I was driving somebody over by there one day, and she was like, "Come here, Mom."
And so I called on the phone, and I see the man.
I said,
and she says, "No, you don't know what I saw her." I said, "From Claremont, Mom. How did you do that?"
No, we didn't.
Hello.
I don't want to go up and down, up and down, and over and around and yonder.
And here it says
that there's principles we need to use, and we can get to use them.
We start living a life that's so much better than the life that we used to live.
And we quit making our decisions in line with what we want to do. And we start making our decisions with what God wants us to do.
I'm telling you, it's not easy, but you're going to do it, and your life changes.
Because you'll be steady. You look at your life now to a good, steady pace. You begin to go forward,
and you realize that God is going to guide you every single day.
And you're not going to do this up and down, over and down.
If you're tired of that, you need to listen to this tonight.
Because this will help you be able to get past your situations and lessons.
Amen.
I found that God had a plan for me. And I struggled with it.
You know that the Apostle Paul spent 15 years in preparation before he really went full time in the ministry. Well, the Lord called me and actually spoke to things about the ministry that I was going to do. But my life was exactly the same as Paul.
It was 15 years before I became full-time pastor here.
And I had all kinds of lessons to learn. But me, the Lord knowing me, even just a young Christian, 2 years old,
I'm not ready to go over this in me.
I don't know nothing. I'll do it.
Can't do it.
I don't know nothing really in 2 years. Just getting started.
Barely got my feet wet.
Three, four years, 5 years.
After all, I thought I'm never going to get to do what I want to do.
But there's still lessons to be learned.
And God is preparing me for my ministry.
And I think what the world's going on here, he forgot about me.
And he knew everything that I needed to do to prepare me.
I'm sure before every job I've ever had has something to do with the ministry.
When I was doing those jobs, I would bet money on a better person than I was, I would bet money that job had nothing to do with the ministry.
And yet it had everything to do with it.
Prepare to get here today.
I'm preaching to you, man.
15 years.
And then when it came time, God started speaking to me about doing it again.
I heard his voice, he said, now's the time.
And I had to make a decision.
I was working at Ace.
And God began to speak to me, it's time to go.
And they had a bus program around, going around here and said, I've got a job.
And it wasn't Ace Hardware, but you're going to get Wednesday.
I couldn't get away from everywhere I go.
I'd stop at a light, and God would speak to me when you're going to submit.
Hello?
It didn't bother you like this, just me.
Began to deal with me everywhere I went.
And I said, okay, I get it.
I'll never forget it as long as I live.
I wrote out my resignation today.
I went to give it to my supervisor.
Gave him my notice, gave him 3 weeks' notice.
And when I went to give it to him, I never felt the presence of God any greater than I did at the moment that I gave my supervisor.
Hello?
I'm not making it in line with what I want to do.
Hello? And if I knew how much trouble the churches was in at that time, I might not have done it.
They just forgot to tell me they were $12,000 in debt before they put money on that loan. On and on, I can tell you all kinds of stuff that happened. But God began to work miracles. God began to do things.
And even today, it's not a place to be in. Unnecessarily having it easy. But it's a place that God needs a pastor. And how many other churches need a pastor tonight? You don't know how many times I go somewhere and someone just starts asking me questions.
I was looking at that myself. I wouldn't pay $350,000 to live in anybody.
pay $350,000 for it. I wouldn't pay $350,000 for it. I know
I'm going to see all the homeless.
I know the city that's there.
I know the people that are there.
And then as it changes, I talk to people. It's the same place. Hello.
It's worse.
Maybe.
God, listen. See how many gates there is for this place. It's getting worse. We are sitting here.
And what we need is old-fashioned time here.
What we need is to get along and begin to assist.
Brothers and sisters, we may need out of here.
Remember, we're going to pray in just a little bit. But you're going to need out of here.
Most people have all kinds of situations.
But they don't take the time to leave him here before God.
Or to turn him over to the Lord.
Or really get into the presence of God.
And let Jesus take control of such a situation.
Far too many people I know. Are still in control of their life.
And they have not relinquished control to God.
Hello.
I used to have long trials and tests. And I'll tell you why.
Because I would not relinquish control to God.
Or I complain about my situation.
Psalmist said, I complained and it got worse.
It did.
Lord, how many more years I've been here?
Add another two or three days to your trial.
Lord, I would like this place. Add another two or three days to your trial.
Lord, it's terrible.
I get it.
Thank you for the trial, Lord.
Thank you for the difficulty.
I love you, Jesus.
Can we show you this thing?
Can we get it?
It took a little while for me to figure that out, but I don't care.
It's a trial, praise God.
I got to change my attitude.
I said, Lord, you're great, you're wonderful.
And I'm not going to complain anymore, and I don't want it to get worse.
And my trials start shrinking.
Hello.
Thank you, Lord.
I'm going to do that one again.
And then the other one was,
If I didn't do it right, sometimes I got to a trial.
But later on, I had to do it again because I didn't like the right first time.
They used to go around Sinai and kept walking around that place 40 years.
You don't do it right, it's another lap around town.
I'm sorry, I don't want to do it again, but I got a lot of time coming.
When I was in the States, I used to make a lap, depending on how bad we were. Hello, run another lap. I don't want to run another lap. I'm trying to do the coach would say, now we're going to take some time.
Paul is talking to the Hebrews, and he's saying that the word of God is the wicked power, so much sharper than any two-edged sword.
And it divides us between the spirit and the bones and the marrow.
And it can discern between the thoughts and the intents of the heart.
That's how wonderful God's word is.
Then he said, we can come to the throne of grace.
To the throne of mercy, which brings grace to the time.
And so tonight we're going to spend some time in prayer.
And I just want to remind you today.
That you need to let your mind go.
You've been making decisions long enough.
Hello?
Can I get one amen?
You need to let it go tonight.
God's got a better plan.
He's going to get you through.
If you let it go, you'll get to the other side, you'll have more experience.
And the next time you'll think, I know how to do this now.
I'm going to thank the Lord for my situation.
And I'm going to let Him make the decision.
Hello?
I tried the decision-making process.
I was terrible.
I don't know how you were, but I was terrible.
It's really a rust,
but I still have a pulse that I'm aiming.
I almost died.
Me making false decisions. Hello?
Someone said,
well, you think you're not very smart?
No.
And I can't see very far down the road like God does. And I'd rather find out what he has to say about the situation.
Then listen to me. Can you see what's going to happen tomorrow at 3 o'clock? God saw that when he made the earth. I don't know how he did it, but he did.
He saw the end from the beginning.
Now you figure that one out.
That'll make you greater. Amen.
He saw it.
That's why it's written down in Ezekiel and Daniel.
The revelation, he saw it.
He knows exactly what's going to happen.
First of all, I know my trials are going to be more than I can bear.
And secondly, I am not going to take control.
Y'all can do.
What you want, I'm to go over to the king.
And you will find me here next week.
God has a different plan, which he hasn't ever.
Zillions years.
I will be back next week.
In trial and test and trouble.
I will be back.
And it must be.
Father, we thank you tonight in the mighty name of Jesus.
And Lord, we are tired of making all our decisions.
And Lord, tonight we are taking all of our care, all of our trouble, as Peter said, and we're casting all of our care once and for all on you tonight.
And we're going to trust you tonight, Lord, that you can make the best decision for us.
We surrender to your will tonight.
And we're going to follow whatever you tell us to do because it will be better than the decisions we're about to make.
Pour out your Spirit upon us, O God.
The trial and test will not be more than we can bear.
But you're going to give us a way to escape.
And you're going to make a way for us to get to this.
We're not going to complain about it because it can get worse.
We don't want it to get worse.
And so we thank you for teaching us and instructing us on the way that we should go.
Thank you for the day on today.
Thank you for your mercy today.
Thank you for your word, your holiness, and your righteousness.
Thank you for the angel that came about to deliver us.
Thank you that everything is going to be all right.
Because you are.
And Lord, we give you all the glory.
And all the praise and all the honor.
Thank you for all the years that I've been here.
And all the years I've been Christian.
Lord, you have been gracious and merciful to me.
And I thank you.
May I not try to wrestle from you in your decision-making process.
Take it down on me.
I don't ever want to do that.
Because you know how to do things better than I do.
And I want your will in every situation.
Lord, we give you the glory.
Praise the Lord, ask these things tonight in your name, Jesus.
Tonight, if anyone would like to come now,
we'll be glad to join with you, anyone at all.
We'll be glad to pray.
Praise the Lord.
Would you stand with us, please, before we dismiss our prayer?
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. One more time, would you turn your neighbor and tell them, I love you, you can't do nothing about it.
Did
you get anything out of this tonight? Say amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. There's a song I heard when I was just a baby Christian. One of the courses I said, I was running from the master. I was trying every new thing I could find. And my life turned into one disaster. Without the Lord, I almost lost my mind. But now, I'm riding in the back seat. and I'm finding it's a very great relief. Now I'm riding in the back seat, and I'm leaving all the driving to the chief. I'm letting the chief drive my car again. Brother Johnny, would you dismiss us? Amen. God bless you. Bring someone tonight if you would be worthy. God bless you really good.